Hi, I'm Ben Galbraith. Welcome to the Palm Developer Podcast.
And I'm Dion Almer, and we're really excited today. Wearing this t-shirt because we've got the guys that created Angry Birds, which has been a phenomenon on other interesting platforms that are out there. And just to kind of start things off, I was just on a road trip down to San Diego to Legoland, and I was in a minivan with a slew of kids. And some adults, and as I was driving one of the shifts, all I could do was hear the theme to Angry Birds in unison from four different locations. And you know, I've got a four-year-old who's obsessed with this game. And so we were so excited when you guys tweeted about, hey, we're thinking about coming to WebOS, and all of our fans kind of stepped up and kind of, I think, let you know that they'd be excited about that too. And so we wanted to bring in Peter. Maybe you could introduce yourself to our audience.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so I'm Peter Vesterbacka, and I'm actually the Mighty Eagle of Rovio, so makers of the game. And Mighty Eagle, actually, you're going to hear more about that character in the game, so we haven't announced it formally yet, but you can expect to see some new birds and new things in the game fairly soon. And that's, of course, now coming to WebOS as well. So, yeah, and as you said, I mean, we were really... amazed actually at the response. We just tweeted that, okay, would you like to see this on WebOS? And we have actually had looked at doing that, and so it's not going to be too tough to do, so we could basically then be pretty open about that we're thinking about it. But then we got, you know, like just in a, like the first day, we got thousands of people sign up to the mailing list.
That's fantastic.
Then we just, okay, yeah, let's get it done fast. And now we're here and it's done. So, yeah.
Well, it's great. We thought it would be fun, Peter, to kind of talk about some of the backstory of Angry Birds as we got started. You know, my family is a big fan of Angry Birds too, and I'd just love to know more about where the concept came from and how you guys came up with the idea.
Yeah, so actually maybe a bit of background on Rovio. So Rovio actually, it's actually an interesting story because Rovio has been in business since 2003. So made, you know, like 52 titles so far, and really the team knows how to make games. But we've been doing that mainly for, you know, more like work for hire. So we've done a bunch of titles for EA. We did Need for Speed, Burnout. Wow. We did Collapse for Game House, which is like their biggest hit. So we've done a lot of like really good games. But then over the years, really wanted to get into the business of, I mean, we knew we could create great games, but we wanted to get into business of making those, you know, for ourselves and making the kind of games that, that you know, we'd love to play and you know, really have a say over what kind of game. So basically, that's what we did with Angry Birds. And you know, Michael, our CEO, came in February, like last year, and then started looking at how to get into a position where we could do that between all these work for hire projects. And then the team, you know, did a bunch of designs, and you know, one of our designers, Jaakko, came up with this idea that actually doesn't look or that it didn't look much like Angry Birds, but it then, you know, the team worked on it, and it kind of like became Angry Birds that you kind of like see now. And it was a team effort, but really building the kind of game that we would love to play ourselves.
Like the details are fascinating to me. Like, why green pigs? Why these birds are like? Are there like characters behind these birds? Or it's like, oh, that's Bob from The Office, and that's this guy. Like,
yeah,
where did it come from?
It's not quite like, okay, not people at The Office, or we wouldn't admit it. but anyway, sure. I mean, one thing that's very important, I think, with Angry Birds is that we put a lot of effort into development of the characters, and that's something that is really important, that you have to build kind of like a story, and you have to get people to relate to it. And then the story is actually, I mean, it sounds crazy, so it's just, you know, like Angry Birds. And that's actually, again, important, that it gets the attention that, oh, you know, what can that be? And you know, and then you explain that, oh, the birds are angry because these green pigs stole their eggs. Yeah. And then it's a simple story, and people immediately understand it when they see the game. Yeah. But first when you hear about it, it's like, oh, you know, like, what?
Yeah,
I think that's part of the charm, that it's again, you know, and then we get, you know, like a lot of, you know, fan mail, and we have like people on Twitter that I hate those pigs, you know, and it's but at the same time, the pigs, you know, like you have that, you know, on your t-shirt there, I mean, the pigs are not you know, like they're not evil, and you can kind of like relate to the pigs, and you know, like all that. So it's not, they're not.
They're tired of grass.
Yeah, exactly.
That doesn't taste good.
Yeah, exactly. And then the birds are also, you know, like they're a bit edgy, and
no, that's what I was gonna say. Yeah, is like you said, they're angry because the pigs stole their eggs, but these are psychotic birds.
Exactly. So I think that's and what's also been like really a lot of fun. I mean, the way the game took off. It's again, you know, first, so we're in Helsinki in Finland, and there's not that many of that, you know, other phone out there in Helsinki. So it's, you know, like home of some other phone maker as well. But anyway, so when we first did the game, then, you know, we just downloaded it ourselves and told, you know, like all our friends. And then basically we came we were in the top 10 very quickly. And then it basically just took off. So we got to number one in Finland, and then just word of mouth. So we've done zero advertising, zero marketing. It's all organic, and that's actually, then you know that you're onto something, because it's you know, we're getting a lot of you know, questions also that are going to make it more social and all of that. But it's actually probably the most social game out there already, even if you don't have like technically the features built into the game, because everybody is telling their friends about the game. And I mean, that's what happened then, that then, you know, we got to number one in Sweden, you know, like neighboring country, and then we got featured in the UK, so then we got to number one in the UK, and basically then the rest is kind of like history, that we then got to number one here in the US, and we've been number one now for 3 months straight. We have been number one in more than 60 countries. So it really kind of like become a bit of a like Angry Birds craze, if you will, without anything but word of mouth.
Wow.
Cool. So how did you get the gameplay to be, you know, so great? Again, like, we've got kids of many different ages, and they all can play this. Like, adults really enjoy it.
Corporate development executives, we know.
This is also, I mean, something that's very, very interesting. Is first of all, I think it's very important that what we did is that we built it for the platform. So it's not like a mobile game, it's a touch game.
Yeah,
and that's something that is, again, a lot of titles out there are just ports, you know, like let's take a successful title from, you know, like console or PC or, you know, whatever, and then let's just like force it onto a phone. And I think that that's totally the wrong way to do it. So we already knew how to create great games, and we've done quite a few, but then take the touch devices and then really looking at, okay, what makes a great touch game, and that's something that is really, really at the center of the design, that we really focus on the experience and the story and everything, and we, like, we're big on role models. So I mean, if you look at like then some role models for us when it comes to games, Nintendo has done a great job on, you know, like you take Mario, and you know, like one day he plays tennis, next it's baseball, and flies out to the galaxy. And, you know, like, but it's a story, and people can, and they're great games. I mean, you kind of like, you get very involved, and you can believe the world that they built. And I mean, what we're doing is we're actually building the Angry Birds world. So what you've seen with the first game is just like a small like glimpse into the Angry Birds world. So that's also why, you know, you can expect to see like some pretty interesting titles coming out, but they're all going to be, you know, similar to what Nintendo has been doing. But another thing is that we want to really focus on creating, you know, rather than doing 100, you know, like not so great games, we're focusing on like, let's make one really, really good one.
The amazing Angry Birds franchise. Yeah. And kind of lean into it.
Absolutely. And it's also, I think that then, you know, talking about role models, we love Pixar. And again, they consistently produced, you know, hits. They don't do bad movies. And bigger hits, smaller hits, but they're all like pretty big. And the reason for that, I think, is that they just do their homework. They really focus on the details. They, you know, build a great story, and then of course they execute it perfectly, so it's, you know, like looks great, and it's, you know, like designed, and it's done properly. And I think that that's what we're doing right now, that's telling people, okay, now we have Angry Birds, we're doing that on you know, webOS as well now, and we're gonna go on all the relevant platforms, but at the same time we're working on other games, and we actually staffed two like extra design teams, and we told them that they can do whatever they like, actually. Okay, so of course some like guidelines, but we are prepared to have a lot of designs done that we're just gonna throw away, so until we're happy. So we're now in a position where we can take our time.
Yeah, it's kind of funny that the world is so different. Like, it used to be each console kind of had its franchise, right? Nintendo has Mario, sure. Sonic on Sega.
True.
But now it's a totally different world where you
can be
yeah, you're iconic on iPhone and that world, but you're on WebOS and beyond.
Absolutely. And I think that it's again, you know, like, that's kind of like ambition. We wanted to create an iconic franchise for the new, like, touch world. And you know, could be like touch phones, you know, basically tablets, slates, you know, bigger displays, but anything where you kind of like touch. And I think this is actually one thing that now the touch devices have really done, that they brought in a lot more people into, you know, using those devices, but also to playing games. And okay, we're actually down in LA for a couple days this week, and then what we learned there, you know, so getting kind of like the jargon and the, you know, terminology right. So Angry Birds is like a four quadrant title, and, you know, yeah.
Learning quick.
Yeah, exactly. And a four quadrant title, you know, for us that are not like in Hollywood and all of that. So it means that it's basically for all ages. So what we see now, that it's, you know, like from 2 years old to 99. I mean, so we have typically, you know, parents buying it for their kids, for themselves, and then they actually show it to their parents. So we have grandparents playing the game. And that's something that is very interesting. And then also it's you know, for men, women, boys and girls, so it's pretty evenly split between genders. So of course we tried to design it so that it's, you know, like, it's a fun game, but also what we ended up with is a game that works for all ages. And we were just we've got a lot of fan mail also from, you know, like 60, 70, 80 year old also that been introduced to the game by their kids, and they're saying that, you know, like, really, you know, like, thank you for, you know, like, bring this game out, and, you know, like, my son introduced this to me, and, you know, and then I just had surgery and I had to stay for, you know, like, at the hospital for a long time, and you know, thanks to Angry Birds, you know, it wasn't like, you know, that bad, and, you know, like, spent time. So it's like, you know, these kind of things that we love hearing that, and it's really seems to work for, you know, all ages.
So you talked about building an iconic franchise with Angry Birds. How successful have you guys been so far? I mean, are you guys just starting to hit the mainstream, or have you already arrived? How do you see that?
A lot of people, if you look at, like, okay, again, you take this, you know, like, very narrow view of, like, mobile games, then you could say that we've arrived. But again, we're not a mobile games company. We're really building an iconic brand, franchise, and entertainment franchise around Angry Birds. So we have only done, like, tiny, you know, like, beginning here. Okay, we have had millions of paid for downloads. I mean, more than anybody else on that other device.
Wow.
Wow. But what we're looking at right now is again, you know, of course, merchandising, but we want to do, you know, that properly. And there's going to be, you know, like, some Angry Bird toys coming out.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And then we're also, of course, we're producing more of these animations that we already have in the game, and those could go anywhere. I mean, of course, YouTube, there's millions of people who just, you know, like, watch them there. So we're really building out the Angry Birds world, if you will, and we think that we only seen, like, a small beginning, but it's a good start, obviously.
So we're just seeing the dawn of Angry Birds and all of its potential.
Absolutely.
So I want to ask you a detailed question. Why the sort of faux retro treatment on the video for the backstory? Like, what was the thinking there?
I think that we just wanted to kind of like get a certain, like, look and feel to that, and that's actually what we intend to keep in kind of like the other videos that we're making. And also I think that's there's a little bit about, like, our approach, that we're gonna mid-September we're bringing out some new functionality, new birds and all of that, and the way we're introducing those things is again with you know, video telling a bit more about the Angry Birds world, the story, and, you know, like, it's kind of like a helps you again get deeper into the world. So it's again, you know, like what you'd see with you know, a Nintendo, a Pixar, you know, so it's really the story is really like everything. So it's so important.
So maybe this is giving away too much of your secret sauce, but you guys have been updating Angry Birds a ton.
Absolutely.
One of the great things about it is that you just wake up one day and all of a sudden you have more levels. How do you sort of make the decision between when you update the existing title and when you create Angry Birds 2 and mm-hmm. have people buy it again? How does that work?
Yeah, so we are big believers in again, you know, like we're here for our fans, for the people who play the game, and we want to keep it fresh, and we have a very interesting, and also we basically. You know, the metrics that we're looking at. So we look at how many downloads we get, but we also really carefully look at how many people upgrade the game when we release a new update. Mm-hmm. Last time we did a couple of weeks ago, 77% of all the people who have ever downloaded the game upgraded right away. So we don't have, you know, like a benchmark in industry, but we know that, you know, like some of these other people out there making all kinds of interesting games as well, but anyway, so they, you know, it's not uncommon to have like 25% upgrade rate or something like that, because people, I mean, just complete the game and then they kind of like, you know, throw it away. Yeah. But so we're pretty happy with that. But again, I think it's very, very important to release these updates, you know, every, you know, 3-4 weeks, and we intend to continue doing that to keep the title relevant, live, you know, so we don't see any reason to. Kill, you know, the title. We just intend to keep it, you know, going. And then, of course, we're working on other titles, but, you know, it might or might not be Angry Birds 2. So we're really looking at, you know, again, you know, taking Mario, you know, as an example. So, you know, maybe we will have Angry Birds doing, you know, they could go out to the galaxy or drive a car. But, I mean, of course, it has to work with the story. And I mean, then another thing that we haven't, you know, like done too much with is again the other side of the story, which of course the green pigs, and they might have, you know, something to say, and you know, who knows, you know. So it's again not so much about creating, you know, Angry Birds 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 and all of that, and I think that's again. I think that's a little bit, you know, like when you see that from like game companies and you see that from Hollywood, I think that it's playing it safe. And it's like, okay, Pixar, another of a role model, of course, yeah, they did Toy Story and Toy Story 2, but it took like Disney to buy them and convince them that, oh, you have to do Toy Story 3. But they're not big on sequels. And again, we're really thinking that it's a bit lazy to just kind of like do, you know, like more numbers.
That's really great. So you keep updating the original while you're working on some new stuff that's really going to excite them.
And it's interesting because like with Toy Story, the way for them to extend it is they have to do another movie. But you guys, it's a whole different world. You can update the game and things like that. So did you look at doing like in-app purchasing and things like that? You've kind of stayed away from that world too.
Let's say that when we do in-app, it's going to be amazing. the thing is that we're not. It would be very easy for us to do, you know, like in-app purchasing and buy more levels but that's like so predictable. Yeah. So of course we might do some of that, but again we want to delight our fans and we want to kind of like do it differently. So it's again it has to be part of the story. It has to be fun and it's like. How much fun is it? Of course, I mean, in our game, it would be fun to buy new levels, sure. But again, I mean, we can do so much better than that. And again, we are asking our, you know, designers and story writers to come up with better ideas than that. So you can expect us to do that with in-app and with a lot of the other, you know, features that they have to be fun.
Well, that's great. Yeah. So. Shifting to a technical perspective, how hard was it to actually do the port to WebOS?
It actually was very, very easy. I think that was like one of the big reasons why we did Palm. It wasn't that we didn't like, okay, hey, there's like billions of devices out there and all of that. I mean, of course, now with HP acquisition, all that, sure, you know, the future kind of looks different. Of course, HP is a big company. So, but anyway, we really made a decision because it was so easy. So it just took us a couple of days to get the first port done, and then we had it up and running. So it was, and you know, I'm not just saying that because I'm here with you, you know, guys. But it was really easy. I mean, it was really, I would say, trivial to get the port done, and then it's just been like testing. So one thing that we do a lot, we really test the release before we put them out. So the actual porting didn't take a long time, but now we've been really using a bit of time then to make sure that everything works as it's supposed to do and all of that. But yeah, the port itself, easy.
Cool. Do you have a particular like homegrown game engine that you use for this?
Yeah, actually, or? That's also one part of it. Of course, that we have our own technology, so it's very we've done games for a long time, and now you know there's a lot of these new mobile games companies here in the Valley as well, and you know they've been focusing on one platform, then looking at like another one out there, and so on, and they're you know concerned about fragmentation. But we've lived in this Java brew world of mobile for many years, and the fragmentation now, like when you look at smartphones, it's nothing. I mean, we used to do like hundreds of different versions.
The J2ME world and stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That was like bad experience. So then you had to waste a lot of time on just, you know, testing on hundreds of different, you know, variations of you know, like devices and, you know, versions and all that. Now it's really trivial. And that was also like with Palm that, okay, you know, we need to test on the Pre and the Pixie and that's it. So I think that was really, really easy. And then for us, current like mobile environment is really, you know, the fragmentation there is trivial. And that's, and also we have the technology that we used in the Java time, so we can very easily support other platforms and focus on creating great games and not, you know, like on the bits and pieces on like the tech side.
Well, thinking about the interface of Angry Birds, I hadn't viewed it from this perspective though before, but it seems almost genius how you could have a viewport of almost any size and Angry Birds still works. Yeah. Was that intentional or was that a happy byproduct?
A bit of both. But I think that what was really carefully, you know, thought about, and if you look at the game, there's very little language. Now when you start the game, there's, you know, it says play. Actually, we're replacing the play text with a slingshot, you know, pretty soon. So the thing is that and that's why we've been number one in more than 60 countries. And you know, if you look at the iPhone side, there's 79 of those app stores. So there's a few missing, but not too many. Mm-hmm. And I think that's also it's a very universal title. It's a very simple story. Mm-hmm. Again, you know, like green pig stealing some eggs, birds get angry, and you know. But then it's something that. Works everywhere, but then also, you know, taking out the language and all of that, that's very intentional. And also like the character development, all of that there's a lot of really a lot of work that went into the design and attention to detail and all of that it's not, you know, like okay, let's not just make a game, but we really carefully thought about everything and then went back and thought about it some more. So it's really really fanatic attention to detail, and it's so important.
And so when you were watching the metrics, and you said at the beginning that in Finland was when it first started to go, then it spread out to Sweden, watching this kind of virally happen in different locales, did it reach a tipping point where like the internet got a hold of it and then it just kind of went everywhere, or did it keep going country to country?
It's actually I would say that it's one of these things that it's a great game. And I think that then that's the starting point. And then the way it happened is that people have just been, you know, telling their friends. And it hasn't been, you know, okay, now what you see is we have, you know, fan sites popping up online. So there's like actually a pretty cool one that I think was this week, angrybirdsnest.com. You know, and I would say that that's like better than our own site. It has like everything about Angry Birds, all the walkthroughs, everything. So it's really, you know, and that's again, like you can see that there are some very, you know, loyal fans. And I mean, that's what you want to have, of course. And we want to kind of like, keep them happy and, you know, continue making the game better and all of that. I just think that it's an example of this, that people love the game, they tell their friends just ended up with this Angry Birds craze because of that. So it's not, we really didn't plan for that. So we just wanted to make kind of like the best game ever, and then, you know, see how far that takes us. And we also what we're seeing right now that it's still accelerating. So we're seeing more sales and more people and
so Rovio doesn't make games for other people anymore.
No. We get a lot of requests. And of course, I mean, we're not never say never. We're really the right client, maybe. Yeah, of course. And again, you know, like you might see, you know, that's one thing that you see a lot in Hollywood and all that. It's, you know, like you have aliens versus predator and all that. So I mean, maybe we get some visiting characters, you know, so we could do that, it has to make sense. And there's a lot of like fun examples of, you know, these kind of things. So we're exploring some things like that you might see. Us visiting, you know, birds visiting some other game, or you know, like
the lines,
TV
like
show.
Doodle Jump with Angry Birds or something like that.
Exactly. Yeah. And you know, the Doodle Jump guys have done a great job. And I mean, again,
crossover kings, right? With Pocket God and all that.
Yeah, exactly. And then I mean, we talk to all of these guys, and I mean, again, we love to do stuff together with, you know, like other people, and especially like indie developers. So again, you know, we're kind of like in the same boat, if you will. So you know, it's great if the other titles, you know, sell millions of copies, because it helps all of us. Yeah. So they definitely, you know, like wanna be part of that.
Yeah. Since I've been sitting here, and you mentioned Mario Kart and the different franchise, I'm just thinking of, you know, a driving game chasing those cheeky little pigs.
Chasing the pig.
I want to get the pig.
Yeah, exactly. But it's also what it's so obviously we're also now on like the devices with bigger screens. So of course the iPad and all of that, we think that that's going to be like a very interesting social gaming experience. But what you see right now a lot, you know, people around this bigger screen on the table, and you know, like playing games and, you know, like sharing information and all that. So we think that you can create some very, very interesting social games, you know, like that, and again, kind of like the next generation of board games, if you will, you know, because now you have that board and you can put it on the table and get together, and it's, again, we all know that you know, like games are really a lot of fun when you play it together with your friends. So right now we're looking at creating like true social games, and you know what, not only, you know, like that you have to take care of various farm animals, you know, like and stuff like that, but you know, actually fun games that are not, you know, like you know, tedious,
friends.
Like actually good games. Yeah. So that's the one thing that if you look at the social side of things. I mean, on the social side, when people talk about social now, it's like, oh, you know, let's create a Facebook game, and again, there's more to social than it's all about people, and we think that, you know, we haven't really seen any good social game, really. I mean, it's again, they're not really great games. So we're looking, of course, at Facebook and all of that, you know, like stuff. But again, it has to be a good game. Yeah. I mean, it's again, a lot of these are just like, then you get annoying updates that your friends just like bought a tractor, you know, and I'm like so excited, you know.
When you sit back and think about the potential that we have with all the, like, we have this network that wires the world and all these devices and stuff.
Exactly.
And so the end result of all that technology is sharing high scores.
Exactly. And it's really, you know, like, they are not good games. I mean, it's really one thing also what is very important, I think that you have to have a passion for games. You have to be a gamer. I mean, like, everybody in our company loves games. We play games ourselves. So if you want to be in like any business, you have to have passion for it. You know, it's you can't create great games, you know, like with Excel, you know, a spreadsheet. You know, like, you know, yeah, the numbers look great, but you know, how much fun is it to play Excel? I mean, like, not a lot.
Not very fun.
Yeah.
There is that Easter egg flight simulator.
That's pretty good. Yeah, actually. So I mean, there are like good things in there, and you know, like, and we have the golden eggs, you know, like Angry Birds, and there's going to be actually like some interesting things in those going forward. But anyway, so I think that it's again. Exactly. And what you can expect to see from us, you know, like if we do something on say Facebook, we're going to do exactly the same thing that we did with, you know, like now the original Angry Birds. We're going to look at that environment and how do you create a great game, you know, the best game ever for Facebook? We're going to make that if we go that way. So we're not going to just, you know, like, okay, let's take Angry Birds, let's make a Flash version, stick it out there, and, you know, like, hope that people like it. Because, again, Angry Birds, as a current game, we could, you know, like, easily do that and just, like, put a Flash version, integrate it with, you know, Facebook, and then have annoying updates to all your friends, you know, and you know, like, yeah, sure, we could do that. But, again, you have to, like we did with touch devices, that you build a great game for touch. And now when you take, you know, like the social networks and all of these things, you have to build something that makes sense in that environment. You can't, we really don't think that you can kind of like just force like some gameplay model or something like that in there. You have to kind of like understand the environment, understand the ecosystem, and then build something that works there. And yeah, it's a great game. Mm. It's all about the great game. If you don't have that,
I'm really impressed that you guys actually seem to say no to things.
Like, I mean, say
it's so
no
tempting
a lot.
To, like, you get a success, you just want to milk it, right?
No. We
you're like really thinking about it.
Yeah, we say no all the time. And the thing is that of course, I mean, of course, we're, you know, like, in this for, like, the fame and also the fortune. But the thing is that it's again, I mean, I don't want to kind of, like, underestimate the challenges all that, but it would be pretty easy for us now to kind of, like, just do a bunch of, like, toys and t-shirts and, like, a lot of different, like, things and, you know, like, be here and there and really, like, over-exploit and, you know, like, put it on, like, the shelves of Walmart, you know, and all that. And we don't want to do that. I mean, it's the worst thing you can do. I mean, you really destroy the story. I mean, it just doesn't make sense. So when we do something, it has to be like what we're doing now. We produce some Angry Birds toys, so we have some prototypes, and they're actually slingshot toys. So they're functional. They work. They immediately when I brought, you know, like, first prototype that didn't even look like an Angry Bird, and my kids, you know, like, saw that, immediate reaction: Angry Birds, immediately. So they immediately saw, you know, that this is, you know, an Angry Birds toy, and that's the kind of stuff that you want to do. You don't want to do that, you know, like, you stick like a picture of an Angry Bird on some something, you know, and then it's like, oh, you know, so cool now, you know. Not what we want to do. It has to support the story. It has to support the brand. So we say no a lot, and it's okay. I mean, we can't, you know, do everything.
So one of the things I'm really curious about is level design. Like, what's the process? Is it just someone just kind of does something and then ships it, or do you guys have like a bunch of testers in house?
We have a lot of testers in house, and more actually now. And we really, again, it's the same thing here that we really, and actually, you know, sometimes even with all the testing, we have some you know, like, hiccups. Or for example, now we did the last update, and then that made it's next to impossible to get 3 stars on level 2.2. And we immediately, like, on Twitter and everywhere, got feedback. So we monitor all of this so that our fans immediately tell us that, hey, you know, what is wrong, you know, like, so, and then we, of course, try to fix it right away. But we really test and test and test. But then also with the level design, that it's, and it's getting tougher now. We have so many people playing the game that we have these, you know, like, hardcore Angry Birds players that they complete, you know, whatever we do, no matter how difficult, they will, you know, like, play through, you know, new levels and, you know, get back to us, oh, hey, you know, that's way too easy, it took me 50 minutes, I have 3 stars and everything. But then, of course, we have, you know, like, the casual, and that's again, like, with Angry Birds, it's so easy to get into it, yeah, but it's really tough to master and get 3 stars. Yeah. But that's part of the charm, but it's really makes it difficult then to, you know, like, we can't make levels like really, really difficult, because then, you know, casual players will never get through.
Yeah,
so we try to keep a balance, and that's big part of testing, that the levels work for everybody. And again, you know, like, this 4-quadrant title I mentioned, that it has to be, you know, like, it has to be like that.
Huh. Well, I've really enjoyed sitting down and chatting with you, Peter. Thanks so much for coming in and taking the time.
Oh, hey, it's a pleasure.
Yeah, we're really jazzed to have you guys join the platform, and we're excited to see what games you guys come up with too.